Welcome to ParrotPod.com with your host, Nikki Moustaki, author of Parrots for Dummies, Your Out of Control Bird, and many other bird books available at your local pet retailer or bookstore. Okay, class, Beak University is in session. Please take your seats. Welcome to Beak University's Parrot Podcast, Episode 4, with your host, Nikki Moustaki. Today's episode is all about weird parrot misconceptions. We've got a fun letter from Postcards from the Perch, a really interesting story in Behind the Beak, and a really cute game show that we like to call Wheel of Feathers. Hope you enjoy it. This installment of Postcards from the Perch comes to us from an African gray guardian named David. I have here with me Lynn Rosenberg, actress and comedian, who's going to do a dramatic reading of our letter. Take it away, Lynn.
Thank you. I've been working a very special interpretation for David.
Wonderful.
So, I hope you like this.
Dear Nikki, I have an African gray parrot named Mookie. He's 4 years old. I bought him for my wife when he was just a baby. The problem is, he's never taken to my wife. He really loves me. My wife is very insulted by this, and though she loves and cares for the bird, the fact that Mookie is much friendlier with me hurts her feelings. She swears that Mookie hates her. What should we do? Thanks, David.
Lynn, that was a terrific reading.
Thank you.
Did you study Steve Irwin, the crocodile hunter?
I don't think that accent sounded anything like Steve Irwin. I
felt it sounded exactly like Steve Irwin.
I've been working on my accent techniques for years, and I would appreciate if you didn't claim that it was impersonation.
So basically, I should defer to your expertise in acting arena.
I wouldn't use such strong words, but sort of, yes.
Okay. Well, I'm really sorry I questioned you, Lynn.
No, it's all right. We can get down to the issues then. All right, Mookie, so what's going on with Mookie that he only likes one of the owners and not both?
Well,
guardians, sorry.
The phenomenon we have with Mookie here is called a one-person bird. Now, this has been a much-debated topic in bird circles, actually, because some people claim there's no such thing as a one-person bird, and some people live with a parrot like Mookie and know there's such a thing as a one-person bird.
When you say bird circles, I picture a lot of pigeons standing in a circle fighting over one piece of bread.
You don't picture like a quilting bee and all these bird people?
Actually, no, that's unfair. I do sort of picture
sewing,
a quilting bee.
Talking about birds
sorry.
In a circle.
Yes. So.
That's not really what I'm talking about.
I'm sorry.
Bird community.
That's good. I like that better. That makes
sense. So in the bird community, we talk about one-person birds. Now, the one-person bird phenomenon is actually completely authentic. And it is when a bird in the household prefers one person only in the household and doesn't like anybody else.
Is this very common? Because I know a lot of birds pick one mate and they stick with one mate for their whole lives. So in a household with multiple people, is it just highly common that they would pick one person?
I mean, this is very common.
Yeah.
This is a very common. And it is very insulting to the other person, the left out person.
Sure.
Because it's like a relationship, you know, it becomes like a love triangle with the parrot.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
People come to me very often with this issue and they want it solved.
Right.
And they want it solved because their feelings are hurt. Correct?
Right. But you can't look at it as about your feelings. It's about
exactly.
The bird.
And so what I try to do is do an attitude adjustment on them rather than try to do an attitude adjustment on the bird.
You know what I learned from this book I'm reading called Parrots for Dummies?
Parrots for Dummies? What
is that sometimes the bird behavior or in order to make a bird's life happy, you have to think counterintuitively.
Yes, exactly. You have to think counterintuitively.
I'm in the first section of the book.
Excellent, Lynn. Thanks for admitting that to our listeners, that you haven't read the book.
No, that I am reading the book.
But eventually you will get to the end of the book.
Of course, I'm savoring
and you'll be
every page.
Blown away.
Of course, I'm already blown away.
Anyway, so what I try to do is have the bird owners kind of change their attitude to see what's really happening with the bird rather than be almost selfishly wanting the bird to like everybody. People often think of birds as perpetual children.
Okay.
And the thing is, they're not children at all. They grow up really fast. So you have to think of a bird as like another adult in your household that you're just friends with, that you get the privilege of living with.
Right. Okay.
So the bird should have the privilege or the opportunity to like whoever he wants to like and kind of be who he is.
Is it possible, though, you know, despite whether he has this one allegiance or the other, that he'll ultimately develop an affection towards the other person, or is it probably going to stay a approximately
the same. Interestingly, occasionally their preferences actually change on a dime. Like one day the husband's in favor for a few years, and the next day the wife will be in favor forever.
Right.
You know, you never can tell, really. Sometimes it's odd. The allegiances change when a person will cut their hair or grow a beard or shave off their beard or go blonde. Or, yeah, sometimes like a small change in appearance on the guardian's part can change allegiances.
Huh.
Yeah. Parrots, they just have, you know, we don't really know what goes on in their brains in terms of towards humans. There's a lot of research that has been done on their behavior towards other birds in the wild. But, you know, parrots have been kept for a few hundred years, but there hasn't been a lot of behavior research on them done with humans for, you know, for the last like 30 years or so. So it's pretty new.
Well, I find that when people with curly hair straighten their hair, I like them less.
You're like a parrot.
I'm much like a parrot. So what do you recommend in the interim while we're waiting for the parrot's allegiances to switch? What do you recommend that they do?
Well, the parrot's allegiance may just stay with David, which is fine. I would recommend that. I mean, it seems to me that the wife, it says here she cares for the bird.
Right.
And she loves the bird. So it seems to me she's probably a caretaker.
Right.
So she should just continue that. It's possible that she's approaching the bird with some kind of trepidation or some kind of attitude that's actually off-putting to the bird. So okay. I would have her take a look at that. And finally, I would have her just get her own bird.
That's true. Well, then is there potential that would spark even more rivalry or more jealousy or allegiance with the husband for the bird?
I mean, it depends. I think there's no point in pushing the issue in terms of her to be close, you know, petting, hands-on friends with this bird. If the bird doesn't want it, to press the issue and to spend years of frustrated time trying to get this bird to do what she wants is wasted.
Right.
When she could have a wonderful bird of her own that really loves her.
All right, that
or
makes sense.
Or maybe the bird will love the husband. But then she'll have to get another bird. They'll just have to keep collecting birds until someone loves her.
Oh,
it's sad.
It's like me and dating.
It's like Lynn and dating. She'll just keep getting them until someone loves her. Lynn is single. If there's any listeners out there.
I don't think this is helping anything.
There was a time when my bird was out of control. He screamed, he plucked his feathers, and he loved to bite. He was just plain weird. Then I got the book, Your Out of Control Bird by Nikki Moustaki. The title says it all. You won't find any gimmicks here, just solid, practical advice to help you help your bird.
And now it's time for Behind the Beak. Picking Nikki's brain for stories from her parrot past.
So there's generally a misconception, or at least this is certainly what I've believed, that if a bird flies away, if a parrot flies off, gets out, it's never coming back, ever.
Well, that's very often true.
Right.
Birds, it's not like a dog where it'll run away and someone will hopefully find it, or maybe he'll find his way back home.
Right.
A bird has wings, and if they're flighted, they can fly, and they just go.
So, but I understand that you had a bird that this was not the case.
Did have a bird that flew away and came back. Now, this actually happened to me a couple of times. I keep my birds flighted,
right?
Because that's the way I believe nature intended them.
That's how you roll.
That's how I roll. I roll like that.
Okay.
Exactly. So I was living in Miami at the time, and I actually had this bird named Miami. Miami bird. She was a Red Lord Amazon.
Not big into the creative names, are you?
No, she came to me with that name.
Oh, I see.
Someone gave her to me.
Blame it on someone else.
She was rehomed. So she came to me. Her name was Miami bird, and she actually had a mate, and they were very, very happy. His name was Milano. Yep. I was going with a theme.
Milano?
Milan, like in Italy.
Oh, cute.
Very cute. Miami and Milan.
Okay, I was
two
thinking
hot,
more
hip places.
I was thinking Milano cookies,
about
like the ones with the
chocolate.
I know
you were thinking that.
I could kill
I felt,
for one of those cookies
felt
right now.
That. I felt you were feeling that. Anyway, back to Miami bird. I could use one of those cookies now myself.
Yeah.
Anyway, okay. Miami bird flew away. So what happened was all the birds were kept, and there was 100 or more birds, and they were all kept in a very secure patio situation. They were allowed loose all the time. The screening was intact, and mm-hmm. everything was fine. They never got away. But one day, it was about 7 in the morning, my parents heard some rattling out on the patio and woke me up, and It seems that a thief had come into the patio.
A thief!
A thief! And tried to steal Miami Bird.
That just Miami Bird, not any of the other
Oddly,
birds?
They wanted that bird. So the bird was gone. The door was open. The bird was gone. Well, what I think
She's
happened...
She's like the Miami Falcon or the
The Maltese Falcon, right.
The way I wanted it
It was
to.
A mystery. But what I think happened was that the thief didn't count on Miami Bird biting. So I think what happened was the thief probably got his hands on her and then she probably bit him and he let her go.
Oh, I see.
Because when I walked out into the yard, there she was, high up in this palm tree, looking beautiful in the sunlight, but far away, high up, and singing and carrying on and just having a good old time. But I'm like, my heart has sunk.
Right.
You know, it's like, this bird is gone.
Do you think she was singing from happiness or was it singing to attract someone, like to get the other bird out there or like her mate out there?
I think she was just having a good old time in this tree in the sunlight.
She was having some palm
whistling
fun.
Whistling and, yeah, having a good time.
All right. So you see her up there and your heart is torn. You're in the dichotomous position of a bird guardian because you're glad that she's free
right.
and having a good time, but also sad that she's
away. I need
her
back,
right.
You know? So I'm thinking this is it. So I stand down there for the longest time in the grass in my pajamas saying, you know, Miami Bird, come back. And I'm calling her. And she's looking at me. She's responding to me, but she's not coming back.
Your neighbors are looking at you and responding to you as well, I'm
Oddly,
sure.
Oddly, right. So I go in and I get some seed and I get like a can of peanuts and I'm shaking the seed at her. And she's definitely really interested, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I spent no kidding, like 4 or 5 hours out there just standing there, like waiting for something to happen, luring her down with a peanut. Well, I think she eventually did get hungry.
Oh.
So she actually flew to a low branch on this olive tree that we had. And I was like, wow, she's just right there, but I still can't reach her because maybe she was 10 feet high. But she really wanted a peanut and she was real responsive to me. So what I did was I very slowly rolled the car underneath that branch.
Did you push it or did you drive
pushed
it?
Pushed it because I
No.
didn't, well, if I turned it on, it would scare her.
Oh, wow.
Maybe. So I needed something real slow. So I put the car in neutral and I pushed it and I got on top of the car and I reached up and she got on my hand.
Did you just say step up?
I said step up.
Oh, that's also in
back.
Parrots for Dummies.
It is in Parrots for Dummies.
It's the first thing your bird should know.
Exactly. But she, you know, she was very attached to me and she was very smart and she didn't fly off. But that I was very lucky.
Yeah.
Because so many people, I get emails every week from people saying, my bird flew away. I don't know what to do. I'm heartbroken.
Is there ever times that you've heard of stories when a bird has really flown like far, far away and still managed to come back?
I actually haven't heard. I bet there are stories like that, but I actually haven't heard of them. A lot of times what happens when a bird flies away, someone will find the bird and keep it.
Right.
They'll think, oh, I found a bird or the owners didn't care about it and they'll keep it. And it's not true. If you find a bird, you've got to try to find the owners.
If I had a bird that flew away and then came back, I would rename it Boomerang.
And that's what I did.
Really?
No, I'm just kidding.
Hey, do you want to read a great book? Check out Parrots for Dummies by your host, Nikki Moustaki. This comprehensive parrot primer contains a wealth of information about avian nutrition, choosing a bird, avian health, behavioral issues, and much more. You can find Parrots for Dummies at your local bookstore, online retailer, or pet shop.
Wheel of Feathers!
Welcome to Beak University's Wheel of Feathers, our game show with your host, Nikki Moustaki. And today we have contestant from New York City, Lynn Rosenberg.
Why am I the only contestant?
Because we're a low-budget operation, Lynn.
Awesome.
Don't ask questions. I'm the one who asks the questions.
Got it.
All
I
right.
promise.
Today's episode is going to test Lynn on weird bird lingo. Lynn will have an indeterminate amount of seconds to
Sweet.
Answer her question.
Thank God.
And her prize will be Parrots for Dummies.
Yay! I can't wait to read that book. Where can I get it if I don't win it?
BarnesandNoble.com or Amazon.com or your local pet retailer. Okay, Lynn, are you comfortable? Are you ready for your first question?
I'm very comfortable. Thank you.
Okay, Lynn. Weird bird lingo. When we talk about breeding birds, we talk about mutation. What in breeding birds is a mutation?
It's when you get different color patterns for the feathers.
Yay!
You got it!
Lynn, you're doing really good so far.
All right, I got one.
Okay. Now, when we talk about breeding birds, this has something to do with mutation. So I'll give you a little hint. Okay. We talk about the nominate bird. The nominate.
Nominate and not dominant?
No, and sometimes we say the nominate color, we say.
Is it the color that's most profound on the bird? The most obvious
yes,
on the bird?
Yes, the color most found in the wild.
Yay!
Lynn's doing really good so far.
I'm awesome. I am on fire.
You are on fire, girl. Okay. Changing the topic a little bit from bird mutation to bird anatomy.
Okay.
When we say a bird has a blood feather, what does that mean?
That it's red.
Lynn, a blood feather is when a feather starts growing in and it has a blood supply.
Oh.
So if it breaks, it can bleed.
That's like when you grow your nails really, really, really long and you start to get a vein into them.
Really?
Yeah.
I did not know that could happen.
Yeah, you ever seen the people that have the nails that like curl over
yes.
themselves and they get a sprinkle over?
That's kind of gross.
They start to have blood flow into the nails and
nice.
It really hurts.
I don't like that. Well, that's
either.
What we call blood feather.
I like it better on parrots.
I think so too. Next question, also about bird anatomy.
Okay.
Going to say a word and you tell me what it means.
Okay.
Okay. Zygodactyl.
Oh, shoot. Egg fingers.
Egg fingers is wrong.
Oh.
Zygodactyl, but you got the fingers part kind of right.
Right.
That is how our birds' feet are shaped. They have two in front.
Bound together. That's what zygote means. It means that they're fused.
Exactly. Two and two.
Right.
Isn't that what that means?
Yeah. Well, like when a zygote, when the egg starts to pull apart,
right.
but it hasn't yet pulled apart, then that's when it's a zygote.
Lynn is smarter than me. She understands root words. I just know what the feet are called.
I studied linguistics, Nikki. You got nothing on me.
Moving on to a question about bird behavior.
Okay.
When we say a bird is eye pinning, what does that mean? When its eyes are pinning.
Ooh.
Should I spell that?
Yeah.
P-I-N-N-I-N-G.
I have no idea. Is it they're moving back and forth really fast?
No.
Boo.
But that was so close.
Oh.
It is when birds get very excited and their irises get bigger and smaller, just right kind of there on the spot.
See, I was going to say it had to do with the dilation of the eyes, and then I second-guessed myself.
Never do that.
That's a lesson we learned. Always go with your gut.
Always go with your gut. And our last and final question, this is a bonus question.
Bonus?
You're doing really well so far.
I hope I get
that
book.
If you get this, you get the Parrots for Dummies.
Gosh, I hope so.
What are scritches? It's slang in bird circles. Slang word, scritches.
When you scratch the little birdie on the top of the head,
that is
give
so
it scritches.
Close.
Oh.
It is a combination of scratch and itches. Scritches. And it's what we do to our little birdies when they put their little heads down for a little pet.
You give them scritches.
We give them scritches.
I'd say I got that right.
I think so, too. I'm going to give you that bonus.
Oh, thank goodness.
Lynn, you have won your copy of Parrots for Dummies.
Oh, I can't wait to start reading.
Add it to your many copies that are already on your shelf.
I have two now.
And thank you for playing.
Oh, it was my pleasure.
You've been a great sport. It's delicious, it's healthy, and it's irresistible to birds. No, not Brad Pitt, though he's nice too. I'm talking about the cooked diets from Beak Appetit, which my birds absolutely love. Hope, my African gray parrot, sits by his food dish waiting for his daily serving of warm Beak Appetit, and believe me, he lets me know when I'm late with it. I cannot say enough wonderful things about this food. You can find it at your local bird shop or stop by the website at www.beakappetit.com. That's spelled www.beakappetit.com. Enjoy!
Have you seen my new birdcage?
Seen it. I'm standing in it right now. It's so roomy and luxurious.
It's from Avian Adventures.
Avian Adventures? What's that?
Only the best, safest, and most fashionable birdcage designer on the market. Check it out Avian Adventures Birdcages at www.avianadventures.com or call 888-723-3607. You'll find beautiful powder-coated cages and stainless steel, all put together ingeniously with no nuts or bolts. Avian Adventures cages were designed by a bird lover who wanted a cage that was both bird-safe and owner-friendly.
What was that number again?
That number again is 888-723-3607. Get the best cage today at Avian Adventures. And Lynn, can you please get out of the cage?
But it's so roomy.
For more information on parrots, please visit www.goodbird.com and www.parrotpod.com. If you have a question or comment for Nikki, please email her at goodbird@verizon.net. Thank you and happy birding!